Hello viewers, I welcome you all to EPG Patasala. I am Dr. Varalaxmi Moganty. I have worked in the area of political philosophy in research and teaching at the Department of Philosophy, Andhra University in Visakhapatnam. The module I am dealing today is titled as Optional Protocols to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, 1989. That comes under the paper called Child Rights. Now we shall deal with the learning outcomes. This module helps one to know about the three optional calls to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, 1989. The provisions in these protocols are in fact extended and reaffirming provisions which are offered by the Convention for the rights of, for the protection of children from involvement in armed conflicts, child prostitution, sale of children and child pornography. And this module also sensitizes one with the issues discussed and to introspect on the social responsibility to address the child issues. We shall deal with the introduction. The UN General Assembly adopted the convention and opened it for signature on 20th November 1918, the 30th anniversary of its declaration of the rights of the child. It came into force on September 2, 1990, after it was ratified by the required number of nations. Currently, 196 countries are parties to the convention, including every member of the United Nations, except the United States. These two optional protocols were adopted on 20th May 2000. The first optional protocol restricts the involvement of children in military conflicts, and the second optional protocol prohibits the sale of children and child prostitution and child pornography. And both these protocols have been ratified by more than 160 states. And a third optional protocol also came in relating to communication of complaints, and it was adopted in December 2011, and it is opened for signature on 20th February 2012, and it came into effect on 14th April. Objectives of the protocols are: the first optional protocol on the involvement of children in armed conflicts requires parties to ensure that children under the age of 18 are not recruited compulsorily into their armed forces, and it calls on governments to do everything feasible to ensure that members of their armed forces who are under 18 years do not take part in hostilities. And this protocol entered into force on 12th July 2002. As of 12th August 2017, 162 states are parties to this protocol, and another 14 states have signed but not ratified it. Coming to the second optional protocol to the convention on the convention, it is on the sale of children, child prostitution and child pornography. It requires parties to prohibit the sale of children, child prostitution and child pornography. This entered into force on 18th January 2002. As of 12th August 2017, 117 states are party to the protocol, and another 9 states have signed but not ratified it. The third optional protocol to the Convention on the Rights of the Child is on communications procedure, is that which would allow children or their representatives to file individual complaints for violation of the rights of the children. This was adopted in December 2011, and it is opened for signature on 20th February 2012. This protocol currently has 50 signatures and 25 ratifications, and this entered into force on 14th April 2014. These protocols came into force to reinforce and complement the relevant provisions of the convention, which is also can be called as CRC. Now let us see the optional protocols that came as intervention to do justice. Optional protocols to the Convention on the Rights of the Child. First, optional protocol to the Convention on the Rights of the Child and the involvement of children in armed conflicts, which came into existence 25th May 2000. Actually, this came into force from 12th February 2012. UN Convention on the Rights of the Child 1989 demonstrated of its widespread commitment that exists to strive for the promotion and protection of the rights of the child. This wanted to reaffirm the rights of children through special protection CRC. And it sensed that the improvement of the situation of children without distinction as well as for their development and education in conditions of peace and security. And it also aimed at widespread impact of armed conflict on children and the long-term consequences this has for durable peace, security and development. Especially the targeting of children in situations of armed conflict and direct attacks on objects projected under the international law, schools and hospitals, the CRC thought of special protocol. CRC thought that definition of child is not specific in the convention itself. So, there is a need to increase the protection of children from involvement in armed conflicts. Nothing that Article 1 of the Convention on the Rights of the Child specifies that for the purpose of the convention, a child means every human being below the age of 18 years. Unless under the law applicable to the child, majority is attained earlier. CRC also took the following recommendations in this contest from the following bodies and institutions. These bodies are adoption of statute of the International Criminal Court and in particular its inclusion as a war crime of conscripting or enlisting children under the age of 15 years or using them to participate actively in hostilities in both international and non-international armed conflicts. Secondly, the 26th International Conference of the Red Cross and Red Crescent in December 1995 recommended inter alia the parties to conflict take every feasible step to ensure the children under the age of 18 years so that they don't take part in hostilities. Third is ILO, International Labour Organization. On June 1999, Convention number 182, recommended on the prohibition and immediate action for the elimination of worst forms of child labour, which prohibits inter alia forced or compulsory recruitment of children for use in armed conflicts. Fourth, the 26th International Conference of the Red Cross and Red Crescent in December 1995 recommended inter alia that parties to conflict take early every feasible step to ensure that children under the age of 18 years do not take part in hostilities. CRC was then thus convinced of the need to strengthen international cooperation in the implementation of this protocol for the physical and psychosocial rehabilitation and social reintegration of children who are victims of armed conflict. The optional protocol to the Convention on the Rights of the Child on the involvement of children in conflicts has 13 articles to provide for these rights. Article 1 insists that state parties shall take all feasible measures to ensure that members of their armed forces who have not attained the age of 18 years do not take a direct part in hostilities. Article 2 held that the state parties shall ensure that person who have not attained the age of 18 years are not compulsorily recruited into the armed forces. And Article 3 states that state parties shall raise the minimum age as per the Article 38 of CRC, and that set for the voluntary recruitment of person into the armed forces. It also insists certain safeguards for such recruitment. These guards are: 1. Such recruitment is genuinely voluntary, and such recruitment is done with the informed consent of the person, person's parents or legal guardians. 3. Is such persons are fully informed of the duties involved in such military services. And 4. Such persons provide reliable proof of age prior to acceptance into national military service. And Article 4 deals with that aspect, that armed groups that are distinct from the armed forces of a state, and they should not under any circumstances recruit or use in hostilities persons under the age of 18 years. Further, Article 6 insists that each state party shall take all necessary legal, administrative and also other measures to ensure the effective implementation and enforcement of the provisions of this protocol within its jurisdiction. State parties undertake to make the principles and provisions of the present protocol widely known and promoted by the appropriate means to adults and children alike. State parties undertake to make the principles and provisions of the present protocol widely known and promoted by appropriate means to adults and children alike. State parties further shall take all feasible measures to ensure that persons within their jurisdiction recruited or used in hostilities contrary to this protocol are demobilized or otherwise released from services. And state parties shall, when necessary, accord to these persons all appropriate assistance for their physical and psychological recovery and for their social reintegration. Further, Article 7 provides for rehabilitation and reintegration and cooperation of state parties for implementation of protocol. It also provides for assistance for such in consultation with relevant international organizations. Further, Article 8 obligates the state parties to submit a report within 2 years of the entry as a state party to protocol. Article 9 provides for an open signature to protocol by any nations. Further, Article 10 deals with the entry of a state into force 3 months after the day after deposit of the 10th instrument of ratification. Article 12 invites proposals for an amendment and to file it with the Secretary General of the United Nations. Further, Article 12 provides for the transmission of certified copies to all states that have signed to the convention. Now we shall deal with the intervention of the second protocol. Optional protocol to the convention on the rights of the child, on the sale of children, child prostitution and child pornography, and 25th May 2000. Provisions of this protocol are, let us see, isn't it alarming to see these children like in such a vulnerable state? UN Convention aim to further the impact of the relevant articles of convention, such as Articles 1, 11, 21, 32, 3, 33, 34, 35 and 36, and to guarantee their protection of child rights from the sale of children, and convention wanted to take measures against such practices like child prostitution, sex tourism and children vulnerability, and a greater risk to girl children due to such practices and the growing availability of child pornography. The UN enforced this protocol to obligate the state parties to guarantee these rights to children. Further, UN Convention was initiated and encouraged by the following international legal instruments and other conventions to enforce this optional protocol, the present protocol 2000. These are: 1. Hague Convention on Protection of Children and Cooperation in Respect of Inter-Country Adoption. And second initiative was Hague Convention on the Civil Aspects of the International Child Abduction. Third is again from the Hague Convention on Jurisdiction, Applicable Law Recognition, Enforcement and Cooperation in Respect of Parental Responsibility and Measures. Fourthly, it is initiative taken by International Labour Organization on Convention 182 on Prohibition and Immediate Action for the Elimination of Worst Forms of Child Labour. And fifthly, it is an agenda for action by the World Congress Committee Against Sexual Exploitation of Children 1996. Furthermore, taking into consideration of cultural values of each people for protection and harmonious development of the child, the CRC, Convention on the Rights of the Child, otherwise called as CRC, evolved this protocol. Accordingly, Article 1 of the Convention insists that the state parties to convention have to prohibit the sale of children, child prostitution and child pornography. And as per Article 2 of the optional protocol, that the state parties shall prohibit the sale of children or any act of transaction of a child by any person or group of person for the sake of remuneration. And child prostitution means use of child sexual activities for remuneration. Article 3 obligates the state parties to take legal measure through its criminal law or penal law for such offences for the sale of children and sexual exploitation of the child and engagement of forced labour and adoption of child in violation applicable in international legal instrument. Further, the UN optional protocol insists state parties to take penal measures against offences such as offering, obtaining, procuring or providing child for prostitution. This also insists penal measures for producing, distributing, dissemination, importing and exploring, offering and selling or possessing of a child for pornography. Pornography means representation of child who is engaged in a real or simulated explicit sexual activities or any representation of the sexual parts of a child for primarily sexual purposes as described in the Article 2 of this present protocol. Then Article 4 insists to establish jurisdiction required to take penal measures. Article 6 provides for greatest measure of assistance for criminal extradition proceedings between the state parties. Article 7 insists state parties to take measures based on their national law seizure and confiscation of goods, materials that facilitate their offences and also for the closure of the premises used to make such offences. And Article 8 insists on the state parties to take measures to protect the rights like protecting their privacy and their identity and victims of the practices prohibited under the protocol. This Article 8 also looks for appropriate legal and psychological training of persons working with the victims of offences prohibited. Article 9 insists state parties to implement and disseminate measures to prevent offences. Further, Article 10 provides for international cooperation. Article 12 for such submission of report to the Committee on Child Rights within 2 years after the entry of the present protocol into force for the state party. Article 13 provides for an open entry to the protocol, and Article 16 invites proposals for an amendment to the protocol and to file it with the Secretary General of the United Nations. Now we shall deal with the Article 8, which is further elaborated as it is a very important article, and it provides for child being facilitated for free expression. This article is very important as it deals with the child rights according to the best interests of the children who have been victim to any of the crimes covered in the OPSC. This article provides for cautions to deal with child victims throughout the legal bar justice process. These cautions are: make sure legal procedures are sensitive to the special needs of the child victim and that the procedures take into account how scary instances authorities should make rooms available that are nice and friendly for the children to tell their story. An audio or video recording of the child victim's story could be made so that the child does not have to repeat the story many times or tell it when the criminal is in the same room. And making sure child victims know about their rights and that they are aware of the everything that is happening with their own case. Further, another guard is making sure the child victim's voice and concerns are heard and considered during the procedure. Further, giving the child victim support throughout the legal process is another guard. Making sure the child victim voice and concerns are heard and considered during the process. Another is giving the child victim support through the legal process. And also making sure the privacy and identity of the child victim is protected. For instance, to ensure the child name and picture does not appear in newspaper or on TV. Another guard is protecting child victims, their family and their witnesses and keeping them safe from people who may try to scare them or hurt them for telling their story. Next, identify the child victims and support them. Let the child not feel guilty for their no fault. Making sure the procedures should not take long. This is another guard. And guaranteeing the safety of the people and organizations who help prevent the crimes, protect children and support the child victims on their way towards recovery and healing. Further, ensure that training is offered to people who work with child victims, and also ensuring the training is offered to the people who work with child victims, such as police officers, lawyers and social workers, judges and others. Now we shall deal with the optional protocol to the Convention on the Rights of the Child on Communication Procedure, which has come into 19 December 2011. This optional protocol to the Convention on the Rights of the Child on Communications Procedure 19 December 2011 came into force on 14 April 2014. This protocol is again a reaffirmation of the rights mentioned in the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child 1989. This CRC is convinced with that all the states parties recognize the rights mentioned in the CRC without discrimination of any kind, irrespective of the child or his or her parents or legal guardians, and race, color, sex, language, religion, political or other opinion, national, ethnic or social origin, property or disability, birth or other status. This protocol came also to reaffirm the universality of human rights. It also recognizes the child right to identity. Most importantly, the present protocol CRC, through its protocol, aims to reinforce and complement national and regional mechanisms, allowing children to submit complaints for violation of their rights. CRC also aims to reinforce the role of national human rights institutions and national mechanisms to implement the convention and optional protocol on the sale of children, child prostitution and child pornography, and on the improvement involvement of children in armed conflicts and to enable the committee on the rights of the child. Apart from this, the protocol is divided into three parts. Part 1 of the protocol deals with the general provisions. It recognizes the competence of committee provided by the protocol, and it also insists that identity of any individual or group should not be revealed. Part 2 deals with the communication procedure, which is the major part. And Article 5th provides for the individual communications on behalf of an individual or group of individuals who are claiming to be the victims of violation by that state party. And Article 6th insists that insists on the states to take interim measure to avoid possible irreparable damage to the victims. At the same time, Article 7 states that some communications which are anonymous, which are not in writing, wherein all available domestic remedies have not been exhausted, and where do such communication is ill-found and as such are not admissible. Through provisions of Article 11, the committee may invite the state parties to submit further information about any measure taken in response to the views of the committee. The Part 3 of the protocol deals with the inquiry procedure. Accordingly, through Article 13, in case of receipt of reliable information on the sale of children, child prostitution and child pornography, then CRC will invite the state party and request them to cooperate in the examination of the information. Further, as per Article 14 of the protocol, after the end of 6 months of the procedure, the committee may ask to inform the committee for the measures taken in response to the inquiry. Article 14 provides for the submission of a report by committee to the General Assembly. Article 18 provides for the open entry by any nation to the protocol. And Article 20 deals with the violations occurred after the entry into force. It states, the obligation of the states vis-a-vis the committee shall relate only to violations the rights set forth are the first two optional protocols. Article 21 invites proposals, amendments to the present protocol from the state parties and to submit to the General Assembly. Now we shall deal with the global status on children affected due to sexual offences, armed conflicts in the Convention on the Rights of the Child. Articles 34 and 39 states that member states have undertaken to both protect children from all forms of sexual exploitation, include the exploitative use of children in pornographic materials, and to promote their physical and psychological recovery, and also provides for social reintegration. But there is a wide gap between the declaration expressed in these articles and with the reality we find. Look at how pathetic it is to see these tender children bearing pain in silence and with fear. Global status on sexual offences. Worldwide, more than 2 million children work in the sex industry. The physical and emotional damage to these children is huge. Girls are often still virgins when they meet their first customer. Within a few months, many are infected with the HIV virus. An estimated 1.2 million children are trafficked each other. And furthermore, most of them are girls and boys. These are trafficked for sexual exploitation. As many as 2 million children are sexually exploited around the world annually. The trafficking industry generates $12 billion annually, says ILO. And armed conflicts in 2014, hundreds of children have been kidnapped from their schools or on their way to schools. tens of thousands have been recruited or used by armed forces and groups. Furthermore, attacks on education and health facilities and use of schools for military purpose have increased in many places. For example, in the Central African Republic, 2.3 million children are affected by the conflict, up to 10,000 children are believed to have been recruited by armed groups over the last year, and more than 430 children have been killed and maimed, three times as many as in 2013. Further, in Gaza, 54,000 children were left homeless as a result of the 50-day conflict. In Syria, with more than 7.3 million children are affected by the conflict, including 35 attacks on schools in the first 9 months of the year, which killed 105 children and injured nearly 300 others. According to the UN verified data, more than 600 children have been killed and over 200 children were maimed this year, and around 12,000 children are now being used by armed forces and groups. Let us summarize. It is worth mentioning here the role of UN Convention 1980 through its elaborative measures and so many steps it has taken through optional protocols. But the convention is only a contributing factor. But the impact shows children are better off now in many ways than 25 years ago. Greatest attention to children's right to health has meant that those born today are more than twice as likely to reach their fifth birthday than a child born 25,000 years ago. The obligation of countries to provide free primary education has meant that children are much more likely to attend the school. Furthermore, in 1990, only 53% of children in the least developed countries were enrolled in school. Today, it is 81%. With greater restrictions placed on employing children, child labor rates have dropped. In the 1990s, nearly 1 in 4 children under 15 were working. Today, it is fewer than 1 in 8. Girls are 1/3 less likely to be subject to female genital mutilation than a generation ago. Now, 42 countries prohibit all forms of corporal punishment against children, compared with only 4 in the year 1989. When the convention was adopted, all these things have happened. But human rights are still deprived for children or human wrongs. A child or an adolescent child undergoes prostitution, it is not an offense on the part of the child. It is an offense by the society to children, and a child is a victim of human wrongs. It is not only a dishonor to family, it is a national crime and a national shame and a global shame to be insensitive to such heinous offenses to the children. These are not crimes committed by the children. It is a crime of the society. And the issues discussed on children, on armed conflict, child prostitution, sale of children, and children used in pornography are the issues related to many social and economic factors too. Factors such as education, parental literacy, economic and social status, social attitudes, role of media, all these play a significant role for the development and protection of the children. Let us see, to further the child protection, we may take some steps. These are, one, the optional protocols should be ratified by the maximum number of member states to strengthen their acceptance as a normative standard and to enhance the protective environment for children. Let us look at another data. A study by African Committee of Experts on the Rights and Welfare of the Child on Conflict and Crisis Africa over the over the last 10 years. This looks at the problem in socio-economic point of view. It involves the measures by state and non-state actors to protect the rights of children during and in the aftermath of such situations. These include psychological impact, education, health, nutrition, food security, separation from parents, caregivers, and gender-based violence. Child rights underlie its analysis, particularly the best interests of the child and the rights of the child and survival, and it addresses and development and respect for the review of the child as evidence through children's voices. Social action as against social tolerance is the need of the hour, says Najat Malala Mizid. She is a special reporter on the sale of children, child prostitution and child pornography. She presented her final report to the 25th session of the Human Rights Council, which is held in 2014. It says that social tolerance and impunity, persistent demand and the lucrative aspect of this trade of children for global criminal networks are only some of the factors that make children increasingly vulnerable. Hence, all should speak out, take an action against these offenses. Now, one caution is in using the internet technology. ECPAT, it is an international research research institution. It comments that this technology is of course by itself morally neutral. So it has also facilitated for the creation of criminal communities that transcend all of the same traditional limitations to community building. Since mental health professionals may have more opportunities for interaction with at-risk youth, we suggest that mental health organizations with youth input to work to develop prevention materials so that they can be used by the practitioners of mental health. And next guard is adequate support and therapy. Linda Johnson recommends that it is important to have therapeutic support, but only after the child feels safe and has a home to go to. Otherwise, not even the best therapy in the world will work on the child. So that is the first recommended in this record is action that all children have a place to go. When safety is ensured, the therapy can work. The second recommended action is to start research programs to gain knowledge and clinical experience to develop better methods of treatment for their victimized children. Then the third step is to develop national training programs for professionals who might get in contact with the victimized children. Now, ultimately, children themselves can take a lead. It is the ultimate step. They can form committees and disseminate children of their rights and measures from law and also from the help of the society. Remember, children feel more comfortable with children alone more than they feel with the adults to share their views and problems. Thank you.